Group Captain Mandrake speaking.
Listen to me carefully. The base is being put on condition red.
Jolly good idea. I keep some men on their toes.
Group Captain, I'm afraid this is not an exercise.
Oh, hell.
It appears that the order called for the planes to attack their targets inside Russia.
This man is obviously a psychotic.
The doomsday machine.
What is that?
A device which will destroy all life on Earth.
Gentlemen, you can't fight in here. This is the war room.
Dr. Strangelove, how is it possible for them to have built such a thing?
It is not only possible, it is essential.
Dimitri, there's no point in you getting hysterical at a moment like this.
I wish we had one of them doomsday machines, Stacy.
Welcome to Fine Movies, Fine Spirits, where today I'm drinking a, has nothing to do with this movie, a cold, cool can of Narragansett beer. It's been in my fridge for about 11 months, and I'm here today, wait a minute, let me take a sip. I want to go kill a shark. I'm here today to talk about the 1964 film, Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb, directed by Stanley Kubrick. Screenplay by Stanley Kubrick, Terry Southern, and Peter George, based on the Peter George book, Red Scare, and starring Peter Sellers, George C. Scott, Peter Sellers, Sterling Hayden, Slim Pickens, and Peter Sellers. But I'm not here alone doing it, as always. Joining me this evening is a man who believes that fluoridation is the most monstrously conceived and dangerous communist plot we have ever had to face, Mr. Christopher Mars. How are you doing tonight, and what are you drinking?
I'm doing well, Michael. Thank you. I am drinking some pure Russian vodka on the rocks.
Here we go.
On the rocks.
Very good.
I wish I was drinking, you know, grain alcohol with rainwater.
Obviously. And joining Christopher and myself is a man who doesn't appreciate my introduction, so he doesn't fucking get one. Our own personal doomsday device, Mr. David Corsetto. What are you drinking?
I'm drinking the same as Chris.
Really?
Yes.
Very, very good. So, folks, Dr. Strangelove, I have a feeling I don't know Chris's answer to this question. I have a feeling I know Dave's question to this answer to this question. First time you ever saw it?
Me?
Sure, you go with you first.
Last week.
Very good. And Mr. Morris?
My first time, I believe, I think I was living in Sycamore Road, so I was probably 16 or 17, so 86 or 87.
The 70s? Oh, the 80s, okay.
You son of a... So I was asking John today, I remember we used to watch it all the time, whether it was Cox Lane or Sycamore Road, so he says he mostly Sycamore Road, so before the bizarro Brady Bunch got together.
Yeah, before the other host moved in on your territory.
Yeah, that's probably why Dave never saw it. But it was a staple. It was something we watched over and over again.
Yeah, it wasn't a staple for me. I didn't get introduced to it until college. I was either in some film history or media something class, and we watched it in that, and I was like, I knew right away. I could tell that it was a great movie and a classic. And yet, I don't think I watched it ever again since then until watching it for this podcast, if you can believe that. But I'm always like, oh, that's a great movie. Yet, you know, one-time viewing until now, a two-time viewing.
So getting the sense, as we were talking earlier, that Dave didn't love this movie, which is, I think it's good that we're not always.
Finally.
We're not always in step completely about how we rave about every movie. I mean, he's wrong, but...
It's not that I didn't love... I didn't love the movie. It was hard to get through the first time. But like you said, I think a couple of days ago, like, you got to watch it again. And so I watched it again today. And I definitely appreciated the Peter Sellers scenes far more today than I did the last time watching it. So I guess that's a positive.
Well, I hadn't seen it. To be honest, I hadn't seen it in years. And I do admit it's not completely rewatchable as far as some of the, you know, the logistical scenes that the actually greatly shot by Kubrick. I was gonna ask Michael if he was gonna pronounce him Kubrick the whole podcast.
While I said it, I go, I'm sure I'm fucking this up.
I'm gonna do something like throughout the whole podcast that I'm gonna say fucking moron if I listen back to it too. So, but anyways, so Kubrick, I think, did a great job. So originally, apparently, it was supposed to be a drama. You know, the book is dramatic. And Failsafe was also developed, adapted from that same book. And there was a couple of different lawsuits. Kubrick had to sue the people making Failsafe to delay the start of that, because that's dramatic movie on the same book. But I guess, you know, I don't know if he and his screenwriter eventually were like, this is very bleak. You know what I mean? The whole plot, obviously, the whole idea of the movie. And then they're like, it's almost funny how stupid
they were saying. Yeah,
it's almost like politicians, so dumb. And it's like, it's almost funny. And making it a black comedy, I thought was a great move. I think it's Kubrick's only comedy, really. Unless you count Full Metal Jacket.
I was going to say Clockwork Orange, but either or. Yeah.
So, yeah, that's one thing I love about Kubrick, is one of my favorite directors. He's just, his movies are so different. All, you know, The Shining, you know, Clockwork Orange.
It's like he made a bunch early on that I'm like, I don't know that. And then all of a sudden it goes bing, boom, boom, boom.
The Spartacus even, yeah. But he made some really good early ones called, a movie called The Killing that starred the general.
Yes.
I'm having a brain cramp already.
Jack D. Ripper.
Yes. Yeah. That starred him. You're going to have to look him up right now, because
is that Sterling Hayden, right?
It's Sterling Hayden. Yeah. Sterling Hayden, who was supposed to be Quint, actually.
Oh, really?
In Jaws. Yes. But he had like tax issues. He lived an amazing life. I'm sorry. What, Dave?
I can see him doing that role.
Yes, definitely. Well, it's funny. He went to school in Maine. I watched a little clip about his life. Amazing. He was a commander in the Navy, I think. He captained his own ships. He did all sorts of things, you know, between acting, and then finally he just went into acting. So, and he was
fantastic in The Godfather too.
He was classic. Some classic movies for Sterling. But
do we do a ding when he brings up The Godfather? Ding every episode.
Oh yeah, that's it's going to be tough to bring that up for next week, but you know, it's possible. It's definitely possible. So, but what's amazing about this is when you think about it, so the movie's made 19 years after World War II ends. You know what I mean? So, you know, the Cold War, obviously, in the midst of the Cold War. I mean, we, you know, us in the 80s always, we did have that fear, you know, of something happening, right. Something could go wrong. But at that point, when this came out in the 64, it was crazy because it was so close so close coming off with, you know, right in the midst of the Cold War at the beginning of it, when it was really, really hot and heavy. So, you know, there must have been such a fear that that actually could happen when this movie came out, you know? Even though it's a black comedy.
So I read something where it said, like, it actually did change some policies. Like, people looked at...
Yeah, I almost sent that to you guys today. It was like, said... Because you saw the disclaimer, I'll get to the disclaimer at the beginning, that said U.S. Air Force would, you know, advise, they said they would prevent such, you know, safeguards. That couldn't happen. But there was another thing. So the article I saw today said everything in Dr. Strangelove basically was true as far as
whether it could
happen. And there was something like a doomsday machine and all of that. So... like I said, it's not, I agree, it's not like an easy watch. It's, if you, it's not completely rewatchable, except for every scene with, you know, Sellers.
Every and version of Sellers.
George C. Scott is brilliant. So the thing about George C. Scott, his performance, which we'll get to, I guess he said he never worked with Kubrick again after this. They played chess and they would, you know, they played chess and Kubrick would beat him, said he never played before. He would beat him and say, I want you to do, play the scene this way. And he told him he was just to play it like goofy and he wasn't going to use it in the movie. He said that, you know, just, yeah, I want to get a bunch of different things and I want you to play it as goofy as possible, which is how his character was. His character was hilarious.
All over the top, yeah.
But he was really, I thought he was brilliant.
Awesome.
Just the whole introduction of him was hilarious.
Yes.
Even that way of doing that where it was all through the secretary.
Uh-huh. Yep.
That was just like, and just his voice off screen, like, you know, take a message.
Yes. And then, yeah. And Peter Sellers was in all three of his roles. It was supposed to be, he was supposed to also play Colonel Kong. Is that what it was? King Kong, which
I love the names. Get,
yeah. Yeah. Very, very, they're almost Mel Brooks.
Bat-Guano, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like a little over the top.
But I think George C. Scott and Sellers actually wrote the screenplay as well, Mikey. Like I read that too today.
Well, Peter Sellers improvised just about everything he did.
Yes. They didn't write the screenplay, but Peter Sellers improvised that, you know, in the war room, besides the great line that we'll get to, I think everything in like a bunch of the phone call was improvised. He did such a good job on the phone calls. It reminded me of Bob Newhart was famous for the pause,
the stammering
and the stuttering on the phone calls. And Peter Sellers, you know, just knocks it out of the park.
Dimitri.
For me, growing up watching the Pink Panther, right, I didn't put the two and two together that he was actually in this movie either, but he was a ridiculous actor.
He was
probably one of the most gifted comedic actors. You can put him up there as all, you know, all time.
Yeah.
He died too young.
Died 52, I think.
Yeah. But yeah, a lot of range on him in this, just in this movie alone, obviously.
Right. Yeah.
So you want to get into it?
Let's do it.
So it starts with the disclaimer I mentioned that said U.S. Air Force would prevent such events. They have safeguards. It's not based on anybody real. And then the announcer talking about the doomsday device, showing that cool shot above the clouds. And then you have the classical, there's like a classical music. I don't know if it's, I guess the song is It Rains, You Get Wet, but it has the... It shows the two planes. A lot of sexual innuendo in this movie, as we could tell. Shows that. And then it has the graphics were pretty cool for the...
They just looked like they were handwritten.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. I thought that was very cool. So then it goes, starts with Mandrake getting a call from Ripper. Peter Sellers plays he plays Mandrake pretty straight. You know what I mean? Like,
yep.
doesn't do much. Like I was
mentioning, he's just reacting to everything Ripper's ridiculousness. Yeah,
very formal. He's a RAF commander on the so it's an officers exchange program, whatever the hell that is.
And his accent, right? His accent reminded me of the soldier in In Inglourious Bastards, old chap. I just waiting for her to say old chap.
Oh, yeah.
I don't see that, Mikey.
That very formal British kind of.
No,
my brain is mush, but yeah, I know who you're talking about.
Yeah.
So he gets the call. Mandrake says, you know my voice. He puts the base on condition red. It's not an exercise. He said it's pretty serious. We're getting attacked. Plan R to the wing. That's, you know. So I guess the announcer notes that the B-52s are always in 24 hours. They have them on patrol in the air, and 16 times all the bombs of a World War II Bomber. And they're all two hours from their targets inside of Russia.
Times.
Yeah.
So really,
and then he says, I'm sorry.
I was just gonna say, really, this whole movie is because of a madman general's
right,
like yeah, jump so
much
or something.
So much different from today's environment.
Right. Exactly.
Kim Jong Un and everyone else. Yeah. Perfect.
Yes. Definitely. Yeah. Completely different. So, and then he tells him to take all the radios.
No offense to all our North Korean fans who are listening. I don't know if they get podcasts, but if you're out there, we love you.
I know. This is going to be a big geopolitical pod tonight. Mm-hmm. Which, I mean, obviously the movie has a lot of geopolitics. But so he tells him to take all the radios. He doesn't want them to hear that there's really no attack by the Ruskies. And so the next scene goes to, you see Slim Pickens, who's great in this. He's looking at a Playboy.
Now,
it's yep.
The centerfold in the Playboy.
Oh, it's the woman who's the
secretary at the beginning. Secretary. Yeah, she's the only woman in the whole movie.
Yep.
She plays both, you know, on paper and in the in Bucks.
Right, Bucks and Buck Turgis. So then Major Kong gets the message, and he's, you know, says, you better, he's like, I told you I don't want you guys horsing around. He checks the code, makes them get the confirmation. James Earl Jones, I think his first role, he's really young.
So young, man. But his voice, once you hear his voice, you're like, yep, that's definitely him.
Yeah. Puts on his, so Slim puts on his cowboy hat, makes a speech. Folks back at home counting on you. And so then the next scene is Buck Turgeson's secretary in her bikini.
Which looked a lot like Natalie Wood. I had to look her up to see who it was.
Yes, she did have some of that. She was in a couple of big movies. But you know, Buck Turgeson, very manly name, obviously. Again, a lot of innuendos, you know, blatant names. So, but she was great. How she would sound very professional, you know. General Turgeson is you know, predisposed at the moment. He says you can call back. So you know, they tell him what's going on, and finally he comes out with his shorts, and we get to see George C. with his shirt open. And then
he was pretty young in that movie too.
Yeah
he was. And then he says he needs to go over to the war room. It was like 2:30 or whatever, and he says I just might mosey over to for a few minutes and see what's up over there. he says you start your countdown before Bucky says blast off. Yeah.
That just sets his character up perfectly.
A little corny, yes. So then you have Ripper talking to his troops. Fucking maniac is.
Oh my god! Yeah.
Telling them they're gonna look just like army uniforms, and you know, fire upon everyone that's within 200 yards. Mandrake comes in. I found a radio. That must be a. Must be a fake, you know, they have no report of this. It must be. So that's when he has him close the door. I guess it switches back to the B-52. Goes back and forth a lot. And they read the prefix. They read the code, which has to start with that three-digit code. That's how they know it's real.
Yep.
And they read the code and confirm it. Starts with OPE. Which is, you know, purity of essence mixed right. up, which we'll get to. That's one of the greatest.
And we don't want to miss all the signs of peace is our profession.
Oh, yeah.
Which I guess definitely. Was actually the real signs at the base there.
I believe it. Right.
So why did he, I'm not a super fan of this movie, so I can't pretend to know everything about it. Why did he go crazy, this general?
Why did he go crazy?
I think he just was crazy. I think
he's
that
just
was
crazy because he said, we'll get to it later, but he said during the physical, after the physical act of lovemaking, that he felt tired.
But he doesn't give him his essence, does he?
He thinks he gives her, Mikey, do you deny women your essence? I was going to ask you that when we get to that.
I'm not sure I even know how to not give
that.
It.
Andrew, Mikey doesn't even have essence.
So he's batshit crazy.
Yeah, right. I think that's just, and it's just like, hey, this is what could happen when a batshit crazy guy.
Yes. This shouldn't happen when just one, one loose cannon. So he thinks they're poisoning fluoridation. We'll get into that because he gives him a nice little speech where Mandrake is great. Marcel is as great as Mandrake. And so this is when, so Mandrake is in the room. He says it thinks it's an exercise. Has him close the door. We really don't want to start a nuclear war unless we have to. I would say something's gone terribly wrong somewhere. Fassbender, that's who it was from. I forget his name in Inglourious Basterds, but yes, he was very proper. Take it easy, Captain, and make me a drink of green alcohol and rainwater. It's the only thing, it's the only thing.
And that stood out. I'm like, what the hell? Rainwater. Trust that.
It's the only thing you can trust.
Yeah.
So Mandrake says it's his duty to order a recall code. He says it's too late, shows him the gun. That's when they do a close up on Sterling Hayden and you see what a lunatic he is. Says president's meeting right now and they'll realize we already have total commitments. And he says something about politicians can't be left to make these decisions. It has to be generals. Says the commies want to impurify our bodily fluids.
The fluids, yep.
Yeah. So then this is probably this is where it gets great, I think, in the war room. And this, I kind of wish I saw this in the movies. Not that I would have been able to, but just look cool, the cinematography, yep. Seeing the black and white, seeing the huge shot of the war room, seeing them.
Yeah.
All in the
best,
war room. So
my favorite character in the movie. I don't know if it's the best one.
Oh,
the president.
Oh, my father.
Oh, Muffler.
No, President Merkin Muffler. Do you know what a Merkin is?
No. Yeah.
Merkin is a pubic wig that a woman would wear.
Yeah.
And then his last name is Muff.
Yeah.
Merkin Muff. Muffler.
Not very, but not very subtle with it. Right.
Yeah. It's subtle on the movie, I guess.
Yeah.
So.
But they later on when he's trying to call him. That's the only time they say his name, right? When he tries to call him on the paper. Right. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's classic. So so Buck gives him the report, tells him what's happening. And President says, why am I the only one not to, I should be the only one to order a nuclear strike. And Buck reminds him of specifics of provision of plan R, which says if the important people are all dead, basically, some of the, they can still strike. That's how,
which he approved. Yep.
Right. So they can still retaliate. So basically to safeguard if they take out the Pentagon or something. So can't communicate with them once they go code received. The radio switch to CMR 114. That's where they have to get that three-letter prefix, which is what Buck knows. I mean, only Ripper knows.
Now that's CRM 144. I've talked to you about that recently because on Doc Brown's amp in Back to the Future, one of the switches, CRM 144.
Really?
From Dr. Strangelove, yep.
What is that?
It's just one switch on the amp that Marty flips. It says CRM 144. That's just a callback to that from Dr.
Oh, Stanford. I didn't know. No, I didn't know if it stood for something.
I have no idea what it stands for. It's just they, whatever they use it there, they put it in Back to the Future too. Zemeckis
too. Cool.
Or
the nice, nice throwback. So then Buck says if it's going to take, the president says it's going to take 2.5 days to get through all the codes. I believe. And then he's like, how long to reach Russia? 18 minutes from now, sir. Yeah. I didn't mention Buck with the chewing gum. Lots of sticks of gum.
And Buck was for this attack.
He was for, he's like, look, if we're going to go this far, it's just easier if we
do. Oh, he's a lunatic. Yeah. Yeah, I'll get to it. He's a fucking nut too. So, This is one of my favorite parts. This whole thing is my like one of my favorite parts. But when Buck reads the transcript of General Ripper to the president.
I have a portion of the transcript of that conversation if you'd like me to read it.
Read it.
The duty officer asked General Ripper to confirm the fact that he had issued the go code, and he said,
Yes, gentlemen, they are on their way in, and no one can bring them back. For the sake of our country and our way of life, I suggest you get the rest of SAC in after them. Otherwise, we will be totally destroyed by red retaliation. My boys will give you the best kind of start, 1,400 megatons worth, and you sure as hell won't stop them now. So let's get going. There's no other choice. God willing, we will prevail in peace and freedom from fear and in true health through the purity and essence of our natural fluids. God bless you all. And he hung up. We're still trying to figure out the meaning of that last phrase, sir.
There's nothing to figure out, General Turgidson. This man is obviously a psychotic.
Well, I'd like to hold off judgment on a thing like that, sir, until all the facts are in.
Of what he says, it's a long speech, and then he says, it ends through the purity and essence of our natural, and then Buck, like with a long pause, fluids. Right. Looks at the president. God bless you. And then the president says, there's nothing to figure out. This man's obviously a psychotic. And Buck, with a great line, he said, I would hold off judgment until we have all the facts.
Right.
And then he says, this is a catastrophe, General. How do we, you know, this is a disaster. This was able to happen. And he said, I don't think it's fair to condemn the whole program, sir, because right. of a single mix up.
He's just like, he's so.
But he's didn't he justify the amount of casualties and the deaths and everything?
He gets to that. So president's mad. That's when he, his secretary calls him. Can't talk now, baby.
Yeah, right in the war room.
Didn't he say he was going to marry her too? Like he was going to make her legit?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, something like that. Yeah.
Mrs. Turgidson, right? Did he say Mrs. Buck Turgidson?
Yeah, Mrs. Buck Turgidson. So, what's great in this, and then the president asked the army commander, you know, what if they can, you know, take over the base. And I think it's Buck that says, my boys can brush them aside. So it's kind of like dick measuring yep. contest right arrogant. There between yep. the two.
Yeah.
So then, but then this is when he said, we have a decision to make here.
Right.
You know, we can do that. We can strike and wipe them out and get 90% of their nukes. He says, basically saying, we need to start it first.
Right.
He sees it as an opportunity.
Yeah. And this is great. He says, we need to choose between 20 million or 150 million. And this little interaction is great. Peter Sellers, president, says, I'm not going down in history as the biggest mass murderer since Adolf Hitler. And he gives him that look, and he's like, perhaps if you were concerned more about the American people than your image in the history books. It's like the balls on that guy.
Yeah.
So then he says the Russian ambassador is going to be able to come in, and Buck's like, you got to be shitting me. You getting him and you're letting him see the big board?
The big board.
The big board. That's great. And then you hear, you know, another over the top name. Get Premier Kissoff on the phone. Then they go to the B-52. Major Khan goes over the survival kit. He goes over all the rations.
What do they got? They have rupees, gold.
Yep. Well, they have they have their rations, the antibiotics, morphine, all the pep pills, sleeping pills, miniature Russian book, which is
the little Bible
and And it's a Bible.
Yeah.
And probably right, rubles, different types of money. Let me stop that. Then you have the issue of, you know, a 9-pack of prophylactics.
You never know.
three lipsticks and three nylon stockings. And then he says, a fella could have a good weekend. And he says Vegas. Did you notice his lips? I don't know if he read into that at all.
No.
He actually said, fella could have a good weekend in Dallas with all that. Okay. He's from Dallas. So the movie was made in 63.
And before Kennedy, Vegas was a big deal.
JFK, KFC.
Yeah.
JFK was shot in November, so it's you know, that was one thing they changed in the movie. But you could see his lips. They didn't really do a great job.
Oh wow.
He says Dallas. Yeah, he says Dallas, and they dub over Vegas. So then you meet the ambassador complaining about the food. Everybody's such an asshole in this, obviously, like all the politicians. He wants a Cuban cigar, and the other guy says, "How about a Jamaican cigar?" Yeah, I don't want a cigar made by what did he fascist stooges? He said, "Oh, only by commie stooges." Yeah. And then Buck calls him a degenerate atheist commie, and that's when they start fighting. And he says, "Look what I found on him!" And this is the famous line, "Gentlemen, you can't fight in the war room."
Yeah. No fighting.
Excuse me. Claims, he says he planted the camera, this clumsy fool. And then they finally get kiss-offs on the line. They switch back to the base. The army's arriving. This scene, this stuff was a little drawn out. You know what I mean? On the shooting, rewatch. Yeah. I don't know if you guys agree.
That was a little drawn out. Yeah. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I that's Kubrick, very thorough, but just on the rewatch, you're like, I'm like, all right, let's get to some more dialogue. It's basically when the army is advancing. I mean, obviously you need to show it. They need to show that just like they showed the plane and everything, which happens later. And, yeah.
Are we on the conversation yet with the president?
This is the scene. Yep. First, the ambassador talks to him. He says, "Be careful, Mr. President. I think he's drunk."
I'm going to be honest. I've never seen a scene where someone's talking on a phone. You can't hear the other person talking at all. Do a better job than Peter Sellers did.
"Be careful, Mr. President. I think he's drunk."
"Hello? Hello, Dimitri. Listen, I can't hear too well. Do you suppose you could turn the music down just a little?" "Oh, that's much better. Yes. Fine, I can hear you now, Dimitri. Clear and plain and coming through fine." "I'm coming through fine too, eh? Good. Then, as you say, we're both coming through fine. Good. Well, it's good that you're fine then, and I'm fine. I agree with you. It's great to be fine." "Now then, Dimitri, you know how we've always talked about the possibility of something going wrong with the bomb. The bomb, Dimitri. The hydrogen bomb. Well, now, what happened is one of our base commanders, he had a sort of... well, he went a little funny in the head. You know, just a little funny. And he went and did a silly thing. Well, I'll tell you what he did. He ordered his planes to attack your country. Let me finish, Dimitri. Well, listen, how do you think I feel about it? Can you imagine how I feel about it, Dimitri? Why do you think I'm calling you? Just to say hello? Of course I like to speak to you. Of course I like to say hello. Not now, but anytime, Dimitri. I'm just calling up to tell you something terrible has happened. It's a friendly call. Of course it's a friendly call. Listen, if it wasn't friendly, you probably wouldn't have even got it. They will not reach their targets for at least another hour. I am positive, Dimitri. Listen, I've been all over this with your ambassador. It is not a trick. Well, I'll tell you. We'd like to give your air staff a complete rundown on the targets, the flight plans, and the defensive systems of the planes. Yes, I mean, if we're unable to recall the planes, then I'd say that, we're just going to have to help you destroy them, Dimitri. I know there are boys. All right, well, listen, now who should we call? Who should we call, Dimitri? You faded away there. The People's Central Air Defense Headquarters. Where is that, Dimitri? In Omsk, right? Yes. Oh, you're calling first, will you? Uh-huh. Listen, do you happen to have the phone number on you, Dimitri? What? I see. Just ask for Omsk information. I'm sorry, too, Dimitri. I'm very sorry. All right, you're sorrier than I am. But I am sorry as well. I am as sorry as you are, Dimitri. Don't say that you're more sorry than I am, because I'm capable of being just as sorry as you are. So we're both sorry, all right? All right.
It was perfect. It was close.
Like I mentioned, Bob Newhart was famous for that, but he was so, his pausing, his stuttering, I don't know, you know, how long.
It was a general conversation between two people not talking about the end of the world, really.
Right. Yep.
It was hilarious. And it was, I guess it was mostly ad-libbed. You know, it was mostly improvised there too.
Right.
My general went a little crazy, and he's sending a bomber here. We'll be there in 2 hours.
Destroy
a country.
It's just so funny how they even start the conversation. Can you turn the music down, Dimitri? And he said, and he says, I can hear you well. We're both coming in loud and clear, aren't we? And that's when he says, one of our base commanders, he went a little funny in the head. Just a little funny.
He went and did a silly thing.
He went and did a silly thing.
So funny.
Well, he ordered his planes to attack your country.
So he went a little funny.
Right.
It did a silly little thing. And then you have the back and forth. Well, how do you think I feel?
So good.
And then we're going to have to help you destroy them.
See George C. Scott's reaction to that.
He's pissed off and like rolling his eyes.
I am as sorry as you are, Dimitri. Yeah, I think he was nominated for an Oscar. Peter Sellers.
He was nominated for an Oscar. Yeah.
Yeah, George C. Scott should have too, but
he's actually nominated 3 times for an Oscar.
Who?
What's his name?
Peter Sellers.
Yeah. Yep. And a Golden Globe. He won a Golden Globe.
I love it. Ends off with, don't say George, you're more sorry than I am, because I'm capable of being just as sorry as you are. So we're both sorry, all right?
Okay, yeah. But he was like, I didn't just call to say hello. He was like, I would like to say hello.
Of course I would just call to say hi. But this isn't that.
Unreal.
Then he says, Dimitri tells him he has to call, he needs to call the base. Or he basically has to call them to give them coordinates, whatever. And Dimitri tells him to call Romsk. Romsk, is that the information?
Yeah.
It's just great. And then, he gives the phone back to the ambassador and he tells him the doomsday machine. And that's like the ambassador didn't know. No biggie. Doomsday machine just destroys all human and animal life
on the planet. Keeps it radioactive for what, 93 years?
Okay, but the Doctor Strange.
We lost you. He dropped his phone in the toilet. He's not in the tub, is he?
No, it's that. But again, that would keep him awake.
That would have been at least that would have been a cool little twist.
I'm back. No, he was creepy as shit. Did he not creep you guys out?
Of course. That was the whole point. That's his. I noticed that
he barely moved his fucking lips.
It was great.
Wait, say that again.
Dr. Strangelove, the character, barely moved his lips when talking.
All right. I'm sorry. We didn't get to him yet, though. At one point,
we do see him in the background when George C. Scott is. I think he might have been on the phone with the girl or something.
I love it. I was like wondering, like, is that a different person? Right. But then, okay, so, well, they get to that soon, but they have next. Rip is talking to Mandrake, asking him if he ever saw a commie drink water. Tells him about fluoridation. This is great. I think Sellers was kind of underrated as Mandrake because his Dr. Strangelove stuff is awesome, over the top. And the president is so funny on the phone, but Mandrake is, you know, straight all the time. And then just doing his laughing, you know, as he's listening to Ripper, and he's like chuckling, telling about fluoridation. And then the bullets, you know, start coming through the window. Ripper gets out his golf clubs, which is like a Browning M19 or something.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
And then he has him help with the belt. He says, we gotta get them red coats or something. The red coats are coming. Back to the war room. That's when, you know, the ambassador's telling him about the doomsday, saying that within 10 months, the whole surface of the earth can't survive. No, sir. It's not a thing a sane man would do. You know, would trigger the doomsday machine. It triggers automatically. designed to explode if someone tries to disarm it. And then they're afraid of the doomsday gap, which was funny. And then they bring Dr. Strangelove in. Do we have anything like that? You know, Dr. Strangelove is praising the doomsday machine, and then saying why it would only work if other people knew about it. And he gives him he said we were about to announce it on Monday.
Right. It's just funny that the whole movie, or the title of the movie, is this
guy's character. Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah, exactly.
Who is fairly inconsequential.
Right.
Why was that anyways?
Just,
I don't know.
I don't know, just, Mike. What do you think?
Just a great name, I think. That maybe that's why they add the or, you know, or
was that character in the book?
I don't think, no. I think they made that all up. I think the book was pretty straight laced, like by the books kind of thing.
Yeah, it was it's kind of funny how when we get to it later, when Strangelove's talking at the end, but you know, obviously a Nazi calls him Mein Führer. A couple times. I'm sorry, Mr. President. And this is all improvised by Sellers too. But it's funny because, you know, the government did have some ex-Nazis working for them. Definitely had some ex-Nazis scientists working for them. And okay, so then you get back to the base after he says it was to be announced on Monday. Fighting at the base, then he tells him, when did you first come up with the theory, Jack? Mandrake's asking him. And that's when he says, during the physical act, of love. That's when he's, you know, women want my presence, but he says, I deny them my essence.
He must have felt like so weird. It's like saying these lines are so out. It's so out there, especially in 1964, 63.
Right, right. Is that right? It's so serious. It does a great job.
It's a good point, Mikey. Very risky.
Sorry, I'm drinking my pure rainwater. So then he hears the firing stop, and he's like, "Oh, my men have surrendered." He's worried about the torture. He's like, "Have you ever been tortured? You know, Mandrake." And Mandrake's like, "Oh, let's." Wants to talk him into, he wants the code. You know, let's recall the bombers now. You know, it's all over. You know,
he's starting to feel like real good.
And Mandrake clueless when Jack goes into the bathroom. Oh, he says, you're gonna wash up, huh? He goes, okay, let me. And then before you hear the gunshot, oh, let me see if I can guess the code. And you get the gunshot.
Boom.
Yep. And then this part's a little long, and you know the B-52 is flying, and
worst visual of any plane flying.
You know, this was a little dated. It's a little dated. I mean, it's probably accurate.
It felt like animated or something.
Accurate, as far as the. Oh, you mean? I thought you meant the radar and stuff like that. So they take a hit, and the plane's going down, and this, you know, like I said, it was a little dated, but and the part's a little long. I mean, that's well shot, probably good effects for back then. And they put out the fire, and they're still flying. And then Mandrake figures out finally the code because he's writing it down.
And that's when Bat Guano comes in.
Bat Guano. Keenan Wynn. Do you remember him? He was an actor.
He looked a bunch of things. Kind of familiar, but I don't think I know him from anything really.
Yeah, been in a bunch of things. And he's a nut job. He's great. He says...
He had one of my favorite lines, actually, in the movie.
You deviated prevert? Oh, you're going to have to answer to the...
Exactly, you have to answer the Coca-Cola
company. So he says, he comes in, he says, who are you? Where's General Ripper? He thinks he killed General Ripper.
Right, he's like, what kind of uniform is that?
Like, why would they have the whole, right? Really, not the brightest bulb. I think you were one of those deviated preverts, he says.
Called him a prevert.
Just obviously an idiot. Mandrake wants to talk to the president. Because Ripper, obviously Ripper wanted to, the president wanted to talk to Ripper. So Ripper's not here. So I'm next. So let me talk to the president. And tries to call. He says, there's a phone box there. Talk about, in a telephone booth. Station to station, he's trying to come up with, tries to collect call. They won't, needs to change. And he goes, yeah, you think I'd go into combat with change, with loose change?
Okay, but let me ask you a question. Why did he keep thinking that, was a pervert? Like, if you try anything funny,
it's just random. It was just
probably, is that what they think of, British people? I don't know.
Maybe it's,
And the way he was calling him a pervert, I was cracking up. I don't know why.
Because he was a prevert, yeah.
Oh, it was funny. And then he's finally, Mandrake gets mad. He says, I want you to shoot that Coke machine. And he yells at him.
It's private property.
Private property. He says, that's what the bullets, I want you to shoot him. Yeah, that's what the bullets are for, you twit. And that's when he says, if they don't take your call, you're going to have to answer to the Coca-Cola company, mister. It's great. So a little slapsticky when you see the Coke shoot in his face. A little vaudevillian, but good stuff. So all the planes are recalled. They're all celebrating. Turgidson's leading them in prayer, and they get a call from Dimitri. And he says, there's still a plane. He's like, that's impossible. You shot them all down and then we recalled the rest. He's like, oh, you only shot down three, not four. And this
too
is
low, it's under radar.
Yeah. Well, is this going to set off the doomsday machine? Look, Dimitri, it's not going to help either one of us if the doomsday machine goes off, is it? And he tells them to put everything they have into those two sectors. Then they go to the plane. So they ran out. They're running out of fuel. So they just.
But let me ask you a question. Did we miss the part where George C. Scott was talking about the plane and how it was going to get through? Or was that ahead of us?
Not yet. Okay. It's the very next scene after it shows. The president says, put everything you have into those two sectors. Then it goes back and Major Kong says, we ain't come this far just to dump this thing in the drink. So he gets a new target. Then it goes back to the war room and they're asking General if they have a chance of, if he can make it. And he's all excited. Hell yeah, they got a chance. He sees what he's saying. It's
yeah, that was good, yeah.
It's brilliant. Brilliant by George C. Scott. It's fantastic if I haven't said that yet.
You've earned it. The movie's earned it.
The movie has earned it. And then they show back to the B-52. go through all the gauges, the bomb doors aren't opening. That's what, oh yeah, they show all the testing on the gauges. James L. Jones, bomb's not opening. He says, I'm going down below. They show the two bombs, hi there and dear John. Circuits are all blown. And that's, I mean, talk about a iconic scene where he fixes it. It's really just kind of amazing when you see that. You're like, what? Like, I first watched it, I'm like, holy shit, what am I looking at?
I've only seen that. I saw that movie for the first time last week, but that scene you see everywhere.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. And he's riding the bomb. It's so great how they do that. And then you see the explosion, and then they go back to the war room, and they go back to the war room, and this is when Dr. Strangelove starts telling them about his mind, the mind shafts.
This was great because you realize it's a man's world. They're like,
oh yeah,
like we could do this. Oh, okay.
Yeah, and he's saying, and it's basically like, you know, genetics and eugenics, yeah. You know, saying we're gonna get the best people. It's very not, you know, the Nazi stuff.
10 good looking women for every one man, right?
Yeah. And then Dr. Strangelove does the great stuff where he stands up. I can walk.
That final line, mein Führer, I can walk.
He's fighting with his hand. And even the president, so the president, even the ambassador, the Buck, they're all excited. They're like 10 men, you know, yeah. Unfortunately, we're not going to be able to practice monogamy. So they're fighting in the doomsday. That's what basically the thing is. They're fighting and the doomsday goes off and they play, We'll Meet Again and shows all the bombs. But that's basically what happened. That's the end. Just shows that they fucked that up.
I think I read in that scene they had like 6 cameras going on Sellers, quick cuts because people were reacting and laughing to all the things he was doing while he was doing.
Oh, really?
I think in one scene, Russian guy, you can almost see him start to break.
Oh, yeah.
He's doing one of the Mein Führer, puts the arm down, and that arm had like a mind of its own.
He was choking himself, and then he was biting the hand.
It was like the Nazi arm.
Yeah. A lot of improv there, but yeah, that's the. And the scene ends with the bombs, and it's obviously very
the end of the world. Yes,
movie scared a lot of people, but I just thought, you know, it was worth doing it. One of the all time classics. You didn't even ask what the Rotten Tomatoes score, which I happen to see accidentally.
92.
Was it 92? 92? No. You say?
No. 98. No, it was 98. 92. I'm sorry. 92 is for next week's movie. Sorry, guys.
Oh, you're jumping ahead. You're jumping ahead.
Well, Chris made me think about next week's movie a lot today, but we'll talk about it later.
Well, Mikey's going to announce it right now. So, but that was it.
Right now.
Put a bow. Okay, go ahead. But put a bow on Dr. Strangelove, classic.
All right. I want to say this. I want to say that it wasn't my favorite, right? But I definitely appreciated the characters. And I definitely appreciated the time of that movie. Like that was so quintessential of the time, I guess.
Yeah, no, right. It was like some of it was dated. I'm with you. Some of it was dated, but very important movie, hilarious, unbelievable job.
And it probably made the people of that generation feel a little better about what they were going through with that Cold War, because it was at the peak. It was at this peak by
better
that.
Better or worse?
I think better because. Yeah, the Bay of Pigs already happened, correct?
Yeah.
So that was tumultuous. So
JFK was gone. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was no. It was a Bay of Pigs. Definitely, what was a Bay of Pigs type of thing.
And
so,
one thing I didn't watch it yet. I don't know if I've ever seen it. The movie was supposed to end in like a pie fighting scene.
Oh, right. Yeah, I didn't mention that. My daughter keeps bugging me about the dog has to go out, but Right. It was supposed to, I mean, right. I don't know how that would have been. It was supposed to be a pie fight.
It was a little too silly, they said. Or
and then one of the pies was supposed to go hit the president, and they would have said, and the general was supposed to say he was cut down too young.
In his prime, right. Yeah.
In his prime, right. So they didn't want to do that.
Yep.
So, yeah. So why don't you announce what we're doing next?
Yes. So as this film was done in the 60s and took place in the 60s, we're actually staying in the 60s in the time period, but we're moving up to 2019 when this film was released. Our next movie, our next fine movie to enjoy, is the 2019 James Mangold film starring Christian Bale and Damon, Ford v. Ferrari.
Nice. Which, I'm very excited. Very excited to do the fifth best movie from 2019.
Okay. Damn. It was 92 in Rotten Tomatoes. And I was looking at Parasite. Parasite was 98. I tried.
Who cares about Rotten Tomatoes anyways? But
listen, I don't care either. You could say Parasite was better. I tried.
Well, it is better. I'm not here to besmirch Ford versus Ferrari.
Yeah, and they all owe it to the.
But I'm going to tell you what I love about that movie. So, Mikey, do you think?
Look, I think we did it. We had some fine spirits. This was an episode without any of David's children barging in. No toenail clipping, no sleeping. He didn't do it in the bathtub. He threatened to do it in the bathtub today. None of that happened. I think we nailed it. So I just want to say thank you guys for listening and subscribing. Anything you want to say? Closing comments, Chris?
Have a good night.
That's killer stuff. And David, why don't you say
I'm halfway out the door. I'm sorry.
Say goodbye, David.
Goodbye, guys.
So close. One day he'll get it.
We talk about great movies while drinking. We talk about great movies while drinking. Yeah, we talk about great movies while drinking. And we feel fine.
I'm just kidding.
Shall we get the ball rolling?
Yeah.
All right. I'm recording. Okay. I'm going to have a much shorter introduction this week because of that asshole Dave made me feel self-conscious.
You should have.
Good.
You sounded like an idiot last week.
You fucking ruined it already.
Fat Nod Experts.